I really have no idea what I'm doing here. Other than going to be completely bare naked before everyone, before you, Lord. Because I really want to take a look at you right now. In the midst of everything. I really just want to look at you. And to say that we have been just crying and weeping for days is an understatement. You did. You warned me that I have an adversary and that they hate you and they're going to hate me too. They're going to come after me with whatever vengeance they possibly can because their time is short, and with whom you are working with in conjunction with in this earth, you are decimating their kingdom, their plans, their agendas. I don't know. I don't know who you do this with and who you don't. But you have. You have allowed such a depth of your refinement process, such a depth of discernment, such a depth of vision and hearing in this time in my life that I don't even think that I can put human words to it. God. But the trials have been very, very difficult. I don't know, sir. I don't know if I'm going to release this at all or if it's just for you and me. I have seen the depths of the depravity of the human soul, even in a child of God. I can imagine the depths of the depravity of a soul that you can see in the straight up wicked who want nothing to do with you or holiness or righteousness. But what is, I think, soul shattering in a way, is to because to see the depths of the depravity of even the child of God's soul, which really means all the different areas that we fall short or have fallen short, it is in itself equally sustained by seeing the beauty of your perfection compared to it. So I can't even behold the things in which I fall short without beholding the ways in which you do not. And if I choose to just look at you with your eyes full of tears and compassion, I can see your beauty no matter what they are saying and putting forth, God. Because they are, you know, they are putting forth a lot. I read things like I read in Psalm 113 with you earlier. And I read how it says, "O ye servants of the Lord, praise the name of the Lord." That's what I'm attempting to do, God. In just telling you that even when they try to show me how far I have fallen from you, if I keep my eyes on you, I get to see how you never fell at all. And you're in me, lifting me up, encouraging me to stand in faith in you, not me. not me. Blessed be the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. Can I say that in my life? Psalm 113. Can I say that from my heart? Blessed is the name of the Lord from this time forth and forevermore. I am fighting with everything I've got in me to uphold the name of God. And I do fall short of your glory, sir. But that's okay. You didn't fall short of Father's glory at all. And you set up a way for me to yoke to you. And when I am weak, you're not. And I have seen the weakness of man's soul in this travail, this place of seeing the depths of the human soul, God. But I keep reading, and it says, from the rising of the sun unto the going down of the same, the Lord's name is to be praised, and it is true. The Lord is high above all nations, which are peoples, God. And his glory is above the heavens, do you know? I understand what that means now. You know, the heavens are created, God. Your glory is far above anything created. Even the most beautiful places that you have made in the heavens. Your glory is far above that because it is uncreated. It is untarnished. It is unmoved. There's no taint or stain to it at all, God. You know, the nameless one fell in your presence. He fell from grace in your presence. He fell from holiness and perfection in your presence in the created areas. Because where creation is residing is in the created. You are far outside of that. Your glory is beyond that of even the heavens, any of them. Any of them. Who is like unto the Lord our God who dwells on high? Verse 6, stunning. Who humbles himself. Who humbles to behold the things that are in heaven and in the earth. You have to literally stoop down and humble yourself to even behold the things that take place in heaven and earth. You are that. Amazing. You are that holy. You are that righteous. And your glory exceeds that of the heavens or the earth. That you have to reduce yourself, so to speak, to even behold the things that take place in the heavens and the earth. But you do that because of the love that you have that exceeds anything we can understand. A love that pursues us to the ends of all that there is, just to recover us. And that is the place I am in. I don't know how they will take any of this, but it doesn't matter. At the end of the day, it doesn't matter what people think, God. The end of the day, I'm literally holding on to your shirt, man. Because this has been a very difficult trial. This has been a very difficult revelation. To watch the places within the soul of man, when the onslaught and the flood comes, when the enemy raises up a flood, you raise up a standard. You raise up your flag, the kingdom against the enemy. It doesn't mean it's easy, though, God. And they have raised a flood. They have opened their mouth and poured forth that waterous flood, just like Revelation speaks of. I've heard it. I felt it. Those words that they say, and your spirit search my soul to see if there's any place found in me that believes their words. And I have fallen short so many times. But I know in where my help comes from, God. I know in whom my hope is anchored. And like Psalm 113 says, God, your glory is above the heavens. And you humble yourself just to come down near me in the earth. Just to behold the things in heaven and earth. That is a love that I still am learning to comprehend. And you raise up the poor out of the dust, and you lift the needy out of the dunghill. Yes. Yes. I can see that in my own soul. That you may set that one with princes, even with the princes of his people. And you make the barren woman to keep house and to be joyful mother of children. Praise ye the Lord. You take the desolate and the empty and the ruinous, and you make it bring forth life and joy. That's our God. That's our God. Psalm 75. Unto you, God, we do give thanks. Unto you we give thanks. For your name is near. Your wondrous works declare. When I shall receive the congregation, I will judge uprightly. I stopped right there. Because whoever this is now, doesn't matter who wrote it. That Psalm 75. What matters is who is that person now? Where have we found ourselves in Scripture? So it says, when I shall receive the congregation, I will judge uprightly. I pray that. I pray that in my own life with you, that you and I are one in the ways in which we discern and we judge all matters. And that when I receive the congregation of your people too, that I will judge uprightly as like you, with you, God. The earth and all the inhabitants thereof are dissolved. I bear up the pillars of it. That's the supports. I said to the fools, deal not foolishly, and to the wicked, lift not up your horn. Lift not up your horn on high. Speak not with a stiff neck. That is to be haughty and prideful against the Lord. That is to think that we have any kind of self-exaltation in this earth. And this person is begging with the congregation and the inhabitants of the earth, please do not deal foolishly. Please do not lift yourself up with your horn. That is not only your voice, but the voice that comes from the altar within. Do not lift that up with a stiff neck. For the promotion neither comes from east nor west nor from south, but God is the judge, and he puts down one and sets up another. For the hand of the Lord, there is a cup, and the wine is red, and it is full of mixture. And he pours out the same, but the dregs thereof, all the wicked of the earth shall wring them out and drink them. But I will declare forever, I will sing praises to the God of Jacob. All the horns of the wicked also will I cut off, but the horns of the righteous shall be exalted. And when I read that, you said, all of the altars of the wicked, like the horns on the altar, shall be cut off. I will cut them off, and the altars of the righteous shall be exalted. And in that I take hope. It is a sure word. The word of the Lord is sure. And the Lord is greatly to be praised. Psalm 86. Preserve my soul. And I start on verse 2 because the screenshot that I took didn't show it all. But before that, Psalm 86 starts with, incline your ear unto me, Lord, for I am needy. Preserve my soul, for I am holy. O thou my God, save your servant who trusts in you. Be merciful to me, Lord God, for I cry unto you daily. I have cried so many tears in the past 2 full days that the throbbing in my jaw, my sinuses, and my eyes, and the back of my head is excruciating. But it doesn't stop because the warfare hasn't stopped. The sifting of my soul has not stopped. The visuals and the revelation he would like to show within the depths of the soul of man, the deepest parts that he needs to recover and cleanse and purify, is travail. That's all that I can tell you, is travail. For I cry unto you daily. Rejoice, the soul of your servant, for unto you, O Lord, do I lift up my soul. Literally, I just sit at your feet, God. And I do the best that I can to face you with it all. For you, Lord, are good and ready to forgive and plenteous in mercy unto all them that call upon you. Give ear, O Lord, unto my prayer and attend to the voice of my supplications. In the day of my trouble, I will call upon you, for you will answer me. Among the gods, there is none like unto you, O Lord, neither are there any works like unto your works. All nations whom you have made shall come and worship before you, Lord, and shall glorify your name. For you are great and do wonderful things. You are God alone. Teach me your way, O Lord, and I will walk in your truth. Unite my heart to fear your name. That I have asked of you. Unite my heart to fear your name. All those things inside of me where the enemy tries to come in to tempt me to turn my back on you. Unite my heart to fear your name, God. I will praise you, Lord my God, with all my heart, and I will glorify your name forevermore. For great is your mercy toward me, for great is your mercy toward me, and you have delivered my soul from the lowest hell. I can see it. You can show it. And I'll still believe in your mercy and love greater than the brokenness of the human soul or the onslaught of the flood of the waters that come from the dragon's mouth. For the deliverance of a soul from hell. From the powers of hell, from the words of hell, from the agenda of hell, from the accusations of hell. Your mercy and your blood and your love will always, always cover all of that. And in victory, in victory. And I was reminded that usually the beginning of a book in the Bible and the end of a book, say chapter 1 and the last chapter, usually has some sort of bookend point and premise to recall and remember. So I read Psalm 1 and Psalm 150. Psalm 1, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord. And in his law, he does meditate day and night. And he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth his fruit in his season. His leaf also shall not wither, and whatsoever he does shall prosper. The ungodly are not so, but they are like the chaff which the wind drives away. Therefore, the ungodly shall not stand in the judgment. And when I got there, you know, stand means to remain, to be alive and remain. And you just said the ungodly shall not be alive and remain in the judgment. They will be judged against, and they will be removed, and they will be forever in death, which is estrangement from you. Nor will sinners be in the congregation of the righteous. Sinners, those who continually transgress you and your way, unrepentant, not returning to you, nor covenant, nor life with you, but in eternal estrangement. And you will separate them from your congregation, you said, so sinners will not be in the congregation of the righteous, and the ungodly will not stand in the judgment. We're under judgment. Judgment begins in the house of God first. I don't know if people realize we're already in judgment. We've been in judgment. You have been judging and weighing us. You have been refining us. You have been enlightening us. You have been shining things. And the spotlight that has been shown within the depths of the human soul, just my own that you reveal to me, I find things in there that have been highlighted that would like to exalt themselves against the knowledge of God. And yet it takes everything I've got in me right now to stand with you, to recall the truth, to stand on the truth, to exalt the truth within. Like I said in the beginning, I don't know who you do this with. I don't know who you open up all of the floodgates of hell to come and to sift such a one as this. But I do remember you saying, Peter, Satan has asked to sift you, and I pray that your faith fail you not. You know what I saw in the Spirit, God? I saw a warrior standing there so wearied by the onslaught that they couldn't hold their shield up anymore. And when I saw that, I thought, this is weakness. But yet Paul said, I will rejoice in my weakness, for when he is weak, you're strong. But what I saw when our faith is challenged and we are wearied from the battle of the onslaught of the dragon against us, and the shield drops, then the breastplate and the helmet and the truth that's girt about our waist and the feet take hits, God. There is no armor on the backside of us, God, because we're not supposed to be retreating. But if we just drop that shield, the one that is to quench the fiery darts, then the darts start to have an impact. Granted, there is still armor on us, and that is to the grace and mercy of God. So I stood there with you today and I said, do I even have the measure of faith that you gave me in the beginning? Is it even the size of yet a mustard seed? And I saw you take it and expand it to where it covered us both like a bubble. And I wept. I wept because of the onslaught of everything coming against me that I felt like Moses who can't hold up my arms anymore. Maybe that's okay too. Maybe that's where the others come in and help. Or maybe that's where you can show yourself strong, because I found the end of me. I found the end of me, and I found the depths of what it can be inside of the human soul, even of your child, where the enemy is with his words and his rhetoric searching hearts too, God. He may not be able to get in there all the way like you. I don't know. But what I do know is that the truth searches out a man's heart. And if there are anything in the man's heart that wants to exalt things that is against the knowledge of God, it's going to be shown. I saw this in the temptation to turn my back on you and trusting you. And I'm just being real. That's been where they're at lately. This non-stop bombardment, to which you said, oh no, they're coming full force in every sector of your realm. Psychological, emotional, your will. your love for me, your commitment, your faith, your dedication, your resoluteness, your ability to know the scripture, to call on the scripture, your ability to stand with heaven or not. They're hitting every sector. Sweet one, I warned you of this. And I felt bad for you because I watch you humble yourself just to come down and swim in the depths of all of that inside of our souls. But if you don't, we're never going to make it. If you didn't, we couldn't make it. If you didn't lift us up, if you didn't grab a hold of us, if you didn't pull out your sword against the enemy, if you didn't remind us, if your Holy Spirit wasn't yoked to us, if you didn't love us with the love that you have and the mercy and the grace that you are, and fight against our enemies, we wouldn't make it. I wouldn't make it. I cannot imagine what life is like on the other side of this. I can't. That's one thing that frightened me recently. I said, I can't see it anymore, God. It's really, really, really hard for me to see the restoration and for me to walk it out in this earth. Like, I can't even visualize it. My people perish for a lack of vision. I kept hearing that. And then the frightened me ran back to you saying, oh, Father, oh, Father, oh, Father, help me. It's about your love and your goodness and your faith, and you are true. You are faithful and true. And it doesn't matter how fickle my heart may be or how much I may be blinded by the onslaught and the flood right now, God. I still choose by my will to love you and exalt you and believe the truth to the best of my ability and to preach it to myself and to stand before you. And to invite you in, as much as it pains me to watch you have to see it all, to invite you into the depths of the depravity of the human soul while you and I look at it. But I can tell you, I've learned compassion. I've learned compassion for the human soul. And I have learned what it means when the scripture says, if your heart condemns you, fear not, I have overcome that too. Because I've clung to that. I've quite literally dug my fingers into your shirt and twisted it in my hand as I grip you. And I'm like, I don't know what else I can do. I've reached a place where all I can do is hold on. I don't know. It keeps going through my head. Who do you do this with? How many do you do this with? Why do you choose some to go through turmoil with you and not others? I don't know why you've chosen what you've chosen, but you said it's all for your good, child. And I have been angry. I saw anger. I saw anger at you. I'm so sorry. I'm so sorry. I don't know. He said, why are you recording this? I said, maybe someone will learn from it. Maybe somebody will feel not alone. Maybe someone will be reminded of the things. Should they ever go through something like this? So, as I read that, Psalm 1, it ends, Psalms is bookended with Psalm 1, which is, blessed is the man that walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor stands in the way of sinners, nor sits in the seat of the scornful, but his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law does he meditate day and night essentially. That is a point and premise we need to remember, and it is bookended with Psalm 50, which is praising God. Praise ye the Lord. Praise God in his sanctuary. God, I pray that I am praising you in this temple, in this life, in this sanctuary. I really do. I pray that you find me and my sacrifice to you acceptable. I pray that. Because it doesn't matter what takes place in my life. It does not matter what I go through in this life. You are still worthy to be praised. You are far above all of this, God. So I praise you in this sanctuary. Praise him in the firmament of his power. Let's praise him in the far reaches, high above of his power. I pray that somehow, some way, you will show me your power, that I can know your power in a very personal way in my life as well. Praise him for his mighty acts. Praise him according to his excellent greatness. Praise him with the sound of the trumpet. Praise him with the psaltery and the harp. Praise him with the timbrel and dance. Praise him with the stringed instruments and organs. Praise him upon the loud cymbals. Praise him upon the high sounding cymbals. Let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Praise ye the Lord. That. Blessed is the man who walks in the ways of the Lord and praises him. I mean, essentially, that's Psalm 1 and Psalm 150, bookended. I cannot do very much of anything but hold on to you right now. I very much am like a child who has gripped your shirt and twisted it in the grips of her fist and is holding on for dear life. Can I believe you lift up a standard against the enemy when he comes up in like a flood. I believe in the rescue of God. I believe in the refuge of God. I believe in the mighty decree of God. I believe in his love for his children. I believe every story I have ever read from scripture of who you are. When the enemy came in to destroy your people, but your people upheld you. You decimated the enemy. So I cling to the hem of your garment. Nay, I'm not even hanging on to the hem. I have completely entwined my fist in your shirt, and it is being wrung by me, man. I love you. And if anybody's gonna save me and love me, it's you. And I see that hawk sitting in the tree right there. You know, it reminds me of the fact that I walked out and I saw him take a dove this morning. And yet I love that hawk too. But it reminds me of how close the predators are, God. I don't even know if they'll be able to see it on that tree right there as we zoom in, if I even release this. But that hawk sits right there in that tree, right at the bottom of the screen now. But we're eagles too, God. And you will take the prey. I have to keep that perspective up to keep you exalted within. I need you to even help me do that. I pray that your children, where they need help from you today, where they need encouragement today, where they need to know that they're not alone, where they need to see that I am not anything that I don't purport to be. I lay it bare. The good, the bad, the ugly, the beautiful. My whole life, I have nothing to hide. And in fact, it's essentially why I'm seeing what I'm seeing in my soul. Because whatever needs to be revealed and brought to the light, it is. And whatever I am not in agreement with the enemy must be fought. I don't just get to sit there and pretend it's not there or roll over in bed and act like there's not an onslaught coming against me. Because there is, and we have to resist the devil. And the one thing that I have found is not only standing up and decreeing and rebuking the enemy, but it is exalting you and the truth within. It has been... it's been so much, God, that I have not been able to essentially do anything but get from the bed to the bathtub back to the bed for 2 days. And a lockdown with you. No one else. Nothing else. Literally being in communion with you. Literally being... falling apart mess before your feet about all of it. Weeping to you. Doing my best to exalt you in the midst of all of it. Being dragged down to the depths of hell by what has been allowed. There always is. He just said to me, why is this good? There's always good in it. There's always good in it. For one, I'm learning the voice of the enemy. For two, I'm looking within myself, and the words themselves are penetrating my heart to find out whether there's a place in me that believes those things or upholds those things. That's always good. Fighting is exercising my relationship with God. So it's not stagnant. It's not left behind. It's going to strengthen our relationship in the end. All of this is for the good of me and our relationship in the earth. Even if I don't like it. Even if I don't like it, God. I think the hardest thing has been me finding a way to praise you and honor you in it. Because when I look at what they're doing and how many sectors they're hitting in us, my cry again is, how long will you suffer the wicked? When will you recompense unto and for the righteous? But then I'm reminded, just like Abraham and Sarah, they had to wait a very long time for their promise to come in, but it didn't diminish the promise. It didn't negate the promise. It did nothing about you and who you are and your faithfulness. But as we can see, it also pulled out all the dregs out of the soul during that time. Was there a place in Abraham and Sarah where they mocked and laughed at God, where they dismissed him or had low faith in him? Did they challenge themselves? Did we hear God properly? Did they challenge their faith? Did they try to, of their own arm and way, to rectify a situation and bring about the promise of God, only not the way that God intended for it to come at all? You see, all those are dregs that you showed up and showed out. So if I have dregs, if I have things that need to rise to the surface to be dealt with, then I imagine if the enemy comes in like a flood, it's going to accomplish that. But I can tell you, it made me very sad to see bitterness rise up from the depths of my soul toward you. You know, that's how he feels about you. So I'm very sorry about that, God. But again, I can't stay in that place. I have to go right back to, if I confess my faults one to another, and I face you, and I don't turn from you, and I do everything I can to exalt you in the truth, we're going to win. You promised us a victory, because you already won it all. So if the victory comes in the morning, God, and maybe it's night right now, it's still coming. And I'm going to hold on. It's everything I've got. Until the morning, God. And I'm going to record some of Romans 8, well, all of Romans 8, a little bit later, God. Because I want to just play it over and over and over. And maybe it'll help someone else, because it's such a powerful chapter and reminder of who you are, of who your children are, how you're going to move with them, what you're going to move in and for them and toward them, in what ways. And I believe I'll be listening to it on loop. I love you, God. And I think I would like to pray for anyone out there who is going through a flood of refinement, who maybe can hear the enemy, or maybe God is pointing out all the places within our souls that need to come into alignment, where we have very much become the opposition to you, the opponent, the one who opposes you from inside that carnal flesh, because it's at enmity. It's not subject to the law of the Spirit. It means it doesn't subject itself to God, and it doesn't want to. Indeed, it cannot be. May we relinquish all those spaces inside of us that wants to stay coupled to a carnal nature in self-reflection and self-protection and all the ways in which we've learned through traumas and abuses and neglects and betrayals in this world to distrust you, or to think that we need to take care of ourselves, because I find that humorous at this point. That's the one thing I've learned, is that, oh, I will never be saved by my own right arm. I'll never be saved by my strength or my own understanding and leaning on that, or anything else that we can come up with on how we think we're going to save ourselves. And I don't want to hide away from you. I don't want there to be a place inside of me, God, nor do I want there to be a place inside any of your other children where they go to get away from you, to get away from the truth, to hide with a lie, to get away from the Spirit of God, because we view you in some kind of, oh yes, where is that? It's probably on my phone that I'm recording this with. But you did show me that. Oh, look it up again, Lord. What I'm trying to say is, if there's a place inside of us in any way, shape, or form that is not viewing God properly, excuse me, I'm typing at the moment. Then he said, if they don't know my love, if they don't know my goodness, if they don't have experiential knowledge with that, if they have a head knowledge understanding of the scripture, but it's having a difficult time penetrating the heart, if there's bitterness and anger and mistrust or anything against me inside the soul of that man, it will cause a disillusionment. And I was typing it in, looking it up again, because he said or an angel did, I'm not sure which one it was, because I was bawling my eyes out yesterday, and I heard the voice say, she is disillusioned. And this is what I said, yes, it's like there's this fog of war, and the onslaught of this flood of the dragon's mouth, and all of this, and I am disillusioned. Here's the horror of what I realized when I looked that up, because the definition is to be disappointed in someone or something that one discovers to be less good than one had believed. Ouch. I had become disillusioned inside. I don't know if that's from the onslaught of the enemy, with their temptation to get me to not trust God. Or if it was there before this and the onslaught brought it to the top like dregs. But there's at least a part of me. And probably because this Abraham and Sarah long promise coming has been so long. And still yet is. That I had become disillusioned in God's goodness and love toward me. I become disappointed in God. Because it says in someone or something. Could be the promise not coming. Disillusioned by God or the promise that I discovered to be less good than what I had once believed. That is what I have been fighting. I will not cover that up. I will not lie to you about that. I will not purport myself to be somebody who does not struggle with that, because that's not going to help you. It's not truthful, and it's not going to encourage anybody who may be going through something where you're not sure about God's goodness or love in your life. Toward you, toward an ends or a promise. So I told him, yes, I think that's the case. I have become disillusioned in this war. I have become disillusioned in my soul, and I don't know why. I don't know if that's past-based trauma responses and patterns repeating, and all they're doing is triggering it, or if it's just the amount of time that it's taken. And even in that, you suspending that answer coming pulled forth something that was still there or could be there or erected itself there. Either way, it needs to be dealt with. Just like that predator is sitting in that screen, that hawk sitting in that tree right there. They're very patient, very long-suffering. The temperature was -1 when this day started. It's been only at about, I think, 5 degrees right now. 5 degrees Fahrenheit. But that is how patient the enemy is in our lives. But that is also the patience of God will outride any predator that comes for us. Your patience with my soul astounds me. Your patience with the depths of the opposition to you in a man's heart astounds me at your love and your pursuit of that man at all costs to recover that soul. I pray you're able to recover my soul entirely, God, by the end of this, whatever this is. Because I desperately only want to exalt you in the truth and be close to you in relationship. That's it. It really is. But just like the wicked fickleness of the heart in this realm, it looks back at self. And it looks at what self is enduring and going through. And as I'm being put through the mill, at some point, my heart began to blame you and it became bitter and angry. I didn't know the depths of that until the flood of all of this refinement came in. For those words, for your word of, is bitterness in her to search me out? Is disillusionment in her? Does she know my goodness? Until it searched me out. But I'm still going to cling to you and not myself. I'm still going to cling to your mercy and your grace and your love and your ability to heal and set man free from these things. Because it is true, we are as free as we'll ever be, but I have to uphold. No matter what I go through, I have to uphold the truth. I cannot entertain the lie. If I entertain the lie even a little bit, I see what can root itself in there. And then there is a place found in me that is in opposition. I am a hostile opponent to your truth. God, help us. I pray for just that. I pray wherever your people are that are in the battle of their lives and their souls to come into alignment with you, to see these areas revealed, that they will find the strength, that their faith will not fail them. I didn't see the warrior put down their shield altogether, God, but they were having a real hard time holding it up anymore. But I saw you extend that faith to encompass them like a bubble of faith around them when I asked if it was enough for you yet. So I pray that you will extend that faith that each one of us has in this process of refinement that you take us through as we're in a judgment period. And if anything has been found in us, God, in this judgment period, judgment comes to the house of the Lord first. And it is the beauty of God to reveal a matter for the kings to search these things out with you, God. It is the beauty and the love of God to show these things so that we can eradicate these lies and these alignments out of our souls so that our souls can be set free in these areas, set at one with God, and defeat the enemy. We have fallen short of your glory in very many different ways, God. Don't let one soul go to the wayside, God, because of weakness. I know you don't, and you won't. Because where we are weak, you can be strong. And it's just weakness, God. It's just weakness. It's not our will being exerted against you on purpose. We are not going to run out of your house on purpose. We are not forsaking you on purpose. We did not come into a willful agreement to desert you or your truth. And I believe you to be the warrior father that you are, who will come with recompense against the enemies that set themselves against the children of God. And you'll come with your troops in tow. Because where your children are weak or where they have found the end of them, you will be faithful and true to uplift them by your right arm. The right arm of the Lord. You've set Christ at your right arm. My bridegroom is my warrior king who will come and set things right and fight the foes against him. Let me not be helping them. Let me not be in alignment with them. Let me confess my faults to you. Let me sit in your forgiveness and your grace and your mercy. Let me exalt the truth and exalt the King to the best that I can. Let me humble myself before you. No matter what happens to me in this lifetime. And may your word ring true as you spoke it, that we will be stronger and better on the other side of this, and you will help many people and pull them from the fire. I pray that, not for my own good, not for my own sake, but for yours and for the sake of their souls, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for protecting your children and for fighting battles that they have no way to win unless you show up as their father and as the king of all that is of creation, whose glory is well above the heavens even, who stoops down and humbles himself to slum it in our souls with us. Just to bring us home and recover us. May we praise your holy name alone for that today, God. May I remember that as we sit down and record Romans 8 so that I can play it again and again and again and again and let it layer itself in my soul. I praise your holy name, God. There is none like you. You are God alone. And I pray that my life pleases you. I pray that my love pleases you. I pray that this fight to exalt you pleases you, then I know your will will be. No one's going to stop your will from being done. No one stops the God who is outside of all of this and over all of this from getting his will done. May my soul remember that, and may the lives of your children's souls remember that. Our Father fights for us, and he loves us with a love we cannot comprehend. And every tongue and knee will bow to him. Help ours do that as well, Father. I love you.